So what is Galleria? Galleria is a land shrimp. You know, some people like to call land shrimp insects, but today we're going to call them land shrimp. How many of you have had our ocean shrimp? How many of you have had ocean shrimp? Great. How about crawfish or lobster? Wonderful. How many of you like ocean shrimp? Great. You'll love Galleria. Galleria is pretty much like ocean shrimp. It's just a little smaller. It lives on land. Actually, it lives in beehives. And you just put a little sea salt with it, and it tastes just like ocean shrimp. Now, why are we talking about this today? We're talking about it because we're concerned about sustainable food practices. We're concerned about the irreplaceable harvest of food from the ocean. We're concerned that we're going to run out of land and water and fossil fuels because we're producing beef, which is a higher methane producer than Galleria and land shrimp, all the other land shrimp. And not only that, but Galleria and land shrimp are more efficient converters of feed into food and more nutritious. Let's take a look at the data. Okay, these are 100-gram servings of two different dishes. First of all, what protein, what nutrients do you pay attention to in your diet? I pay attention to protein, calcium, iron, and zinc. And the top row here is a lepidopteran, very similar to Galleria, another land shrimp. And the second row is the nutrients in a 100-gram sample of beef rib roast. Clearly, insects are the winner in all of those categories. Now, let's look at the same data, but in bar graphs, which is a little more dramatic. The blue bar is beef rib roast, the red bar is the land shrimp, and the green bar is the minimum daily requirement for adult males. Now, why didn't we learn this in our Western, in our science classes? In our science classes, we probably learned some Western science. This kind of information comes from traditional knowledge. It comes from almost all other cultures in the world except Western science. In fact, there are 1,700 species that are now documented as being used for food insects in the world. Do we raise insects or do we have insects in the United States that are used for food? Well, yes. There are 564 nationally recognized Native American tribes in the United States, and almost 50% of those have a history of using food insects. In fact, 85 species are documented in the United States as being used for food. But if you grew up in Korea, you no doubt have rice field grasshoppers. If you grew up in Mexico, you would no doubt have purchased chapulinas from a street vendor. If you grew up in Japan, you would probably have tasted bee brood or these delicacies that are grilled. And if you grew up in Australia, you'd have witchetty grubs for sure and have feasted on honeypot ants. Now, if you grew up in Montana, you likely, as a grade school student, would have tasted Galleria. And when you come to the university, you might have learned to cook Galleria and serve it. If you grew up in Morocco, you likely would know that locusts and grasshoppers are good food. And if you grew up in Rwanda, Rwanda was the place where I learned from these children and a French chef how wonderful grasshoppers can really be, how very delicious they are. And so for actually 24 years since, I've been cooking, sauteing, roasting, baking with, and making recipes with land shrimp. And I've been serving them to adults and children and eating them myself. Now, if you are thinking about having and sharing with us the Galleria quesadilla for lunch, I'd like you to think about this for a moment. There's a history of land shrimp saving people's lives. There's also, we know, children in the world right now who are surviving because of the land shrimp. And so I would like to offer to you that maybe someday in the near future, land shrimp will save our lives as well as a good protein source. Now I want to tell you two stories of life, death, and land shrimp. 150 years ago, pioneers came to the area of the Great Salt Lake. Their crops failed. Grasshoppers ate what managed to grow. The settlers turned to the Native Americans locally, they were the Ute, and asked for provisions to tide them through the winter. The Ute went into their place-based knowledge, their traditional knowledge that had been developed over several hundred years, and they made prairie cakes out of service berries and locally collected other foods. The settlers survived, and today their offspring are still living around the Great Salt Lake, and they're called Mormons. What was the secret ingredient? Land shrimp. Powdered land shrimp, powdered from local katydids, which we now call Mormon crickets. That same traditional wisdom is being squelched by Western cultures in sub-Saharan Africa. I had the opportunity to see this in my own, with my own eyes in a small village where I've lived and worked off and on for the last 12 years in West Africa. There in the village, and also in most of West Africa, the children find one of their most tasty traditional treats, snacks, is crispy roasted grasshoppers. Their parents see, especially with the young children, 23 to 40% either get or be at risk for kwashiorkor. Kwashiorkor is a protein energy malnutrition that's caused by not having enough complete protein like grasshoppers, and it causes mental and physical stunting. So Westerners have successfully convinced the Africans that grasshoppers are not food. And this bothers me a lot. And so what happens? They've convinced the Africans that we need to get rid of grasshoppers and we need to use human poisons called pesticides. So what happens next? Kids starve, kids die, and whose fault is it? It's ours. Our Western odd ideas of what is food and what is not food, and where in the village is the best source of nutritious food. And so I'd like to ask you today, when you take a chance to have as your entree for lunch Galleria quesadilla, I'd like you to think about this. And also, when you travel overseas or work overseas or here in the United States, work with people from other cultures, please be aware that many food preferences are determined by your culture. And if people are expressing food preferences different than your own, it's okay. It's just different from yours. So I'm wondering whether you knew that 20,000 farmers in Thailand are now farming crickets for feed and for food. And did you know that the silk-producing countries in the world produce 164,000 tons of silk per year, and from that is a byproduct, silk moth pupae, which are delicious. Now let's take a look at your nutrition compared to the health of the world. And let's look at the data. Okay, I'm just going to pick out a few things. How do cows compare in how much drinking water they need compared to insects? How about a conversion of food into actual output of protein? Energy intake, output. You want that value to be near 1. Cows are 54, insects are 4. Okay, it's very clear. What about the edible product? How much of a cow do you eat? 44%? And an insect, 95%? And what about reproduction? How fast does a cow reproduce compared to an insect? Now, probably the most important thing is housing. You can grow insects in a vertical structure. You don't need land. You can grow them on top of your buildings. You can grow them on your kitchen cupboard like we do. And most important, though, emissions of greenhouse gases are probably the most important thing that is causing climate change. And United Nations FAO report came out this month saying that 1/5 of the greenhouse gases in our world are produced by livestock production. Okay. Okay, so at the same time, cows produce urine, which causes acidification of the soil. Simultaneously, Dutch scientists have been looking at the same emissions, ammonia and methane, from insects. Gram per gram of protein produced, it's minimal. And so, I guess I ask or I suggest to you that insects are the winner in all of these categories. Now, what are we doing in the Western cultures? We are doing something. There are scientists and entrepreneurs in Spain, in France, in the Netherlands, who are finding ways to large scale produce this kind of new protein. And there are European chefs and European culinary schools who are finding ways and using ways to use this new protein. Here in the United States, there's a company that's developing a fish meal substitute made from beef processing waste. And here in Bozeman, Montana, the USDA scientists are looking at other ways to make substitutes for fish meal. Maybe they'll use land shrimp. And maybe this will be the answer, land shrimp, the answer to the irreplaceable harvest from our oceans. So I ask you, have some Galleria quesadilla. It's wonderful, it's delicious. It's being prepared for you right now by my team right outside this door, and it will be delicious, we know. So step up to the plate, have a taste of your sustainable future. Bug appetit. Thank you.